The fastest thing in the universe. 299,799,458 meters per second. So fast, it can orbit the Earth 7 times in 1 second. So fast, it can cover the distance between Earth and the Sun, 149 million kilometers, in about 8 minutes and 20 seconds. But it's not fast enough. The universe is just too massive. The nearest star is about 4 light years away. Our Milky Way is 100,000 light years across, and the observable universe, well, that is 98 billion light years in diameter. And that is not a mistake. So how can we, as humans, expand to other areas of space if the fastest thing is just too slow? Well, we just have to find a way, right? We like to live with the thought that anything is possible, and that's a noble thought. Probably pushed us much further than what we would have been without that thought. However, breaking the speed of light, that's a different story. This is not the same case as when people said, man will never fly, because at least they could look up and see something flying, an observation in nature. But something traveling faster than the speed of light? Never been observed. Right now, and probably for a really long time, if you wanted to travel faster than the speed of light within the current laws of physics, you would need an infinite amount of energy. Not only that, as you go nearer and nearer towards the speed of light, you would need more and more energy to accelerate you further. And that is a problem. Yes, there are all sorts of proposed methods in order to go faster than the speed of light. And you've probably seen some of those methods in countless TV shows, movies, books, whatever it is that you like to read or watch. And some of those methods do actually have scientific merit to them. Things like warp drive and wormholes. Thing is, those don't actually let you go faster than the speed of light. They actually zigzag around that speed limit. And they involve many things that might not even exist, and they're just theoretical at the moment. So what am I saying here? What is the point in me saying this? The point is, can we find a way to get around this? Let me quote NASA for you. The bad news is that the bulk of scientific research we have accumulated to date concludes that faster than light travel is impossible. So if it turns out that light speed travel is not just impossible today, but for the entirety of the future itself, what do we do? Should we give up on our dreams to conquer space? No. And in this video, I will show you one method where we don't need to travel faster than the speed of light. We don't even need to travel at 90%, 80%, 50%, or even 20%. All we need is 1% the speed of light, and later on, 10%. Well, that, along with a few technological developments that are based on things that are already here in nature. Now, when I say 1% the speed of light, 1% speed of light is still pretty fast. That's like 3,000 kilometers a second. We don't have something that can go that fast. However, the methods proposed to reach speeds such as 1% the speed of light are more realistic and based on things that exist, not like faster than light proposed methods of travel. For example, you have something called nuclear pulse propulsion, and that depends on firing a continuous barrage of nuclear explosions in order to push the spacecraft forward. You also have something called a fusion rocket, where it would use a fusion reactor that would produce energy the same way as our sun would produce energy. Very efficient, along with many other proposed methods. So, now, we can imagine that we have a spacecraft that travels 1% the speed of light. So what? Here is the thing. Even if you have a spacecraft that can travel at 1% the speed of light, it will still take almost 400 years to make it to the nearest solar system. You can't wait that long, right? Well, you might not be able to, but the universe can, because it will be here for a really, really, really long time. As long as humanity makes it to other areas in space in one form or another, that would be fine. And this is where the next technology that we would need comes in. And it is called embryo cryopreservation, which is basically freezing human embryos for later use. It doesn't have to be human embryos, it can be any kind of embryo. Anyway, you might be saying, why don't we freeze entire humans and then send them off in space instead of freezing embryos? Well, that might be possible, and it might not really be possible, but let's focus here on something that we have actually been doing successfully since 1983. Okay, so now we have a spacecraft that can travel at 1% the speed of light and carries with it the seed of humanity. That's good, but who's supposed to take care of those human embryos? I'm glad you asked. That would be the ship itself. The ship should have a system that allows it to go to a body in space, analyze what's available on that body, analyze whether it's fit for human development, and then land on that body, use the resources on that body to create a facility in order for humans to develop, and then eventually even build a ship similar to itself in order to launch even further. That part is really important, and you will know why later on. This means that the ship would need artificial intelligence. Yes, a very controversial thing. Is artificial intelligence possible? Well, there are many developments in the field, and it's really technical, to say the least. But here is the thing. As long as it can be observed in nature, then it should be possible. And what is something that can be observed in nature that can think and learn for itself, that has high intelligence? That would be you. Humans have high intelligence. Therefore, it should be possible to create something that can think and learn like humans, and maybe even better. So with all that said, what happens next? For that, I would like for us to go into an imaginary period where we launched spaceships similar to the one I just described to you now. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to disappear, I'll come back, but it will be a completely different atmosphere. So, here we go. The year is 2502. Over the past 50 years, humanity pooled its resources to build 10 of the first ever spacecrafts of their kind. Ones that can accelerate to 1% the speed of light. Ones that have thousands of cryogenically frozen human embryos on them. And most importantly, ones that have the intelligence necessary to fare through space on their own. On July 16th of the same year, humanity launched those spacecrafts as part of an expedition labeled Mission Mankind. Each spacecraft heads to a different nearby star system. Almost 500 years later, ship Alpha 422 has arrived at the Alpha Centauri system. For 2 years, it scours for a suitable location. It found it, an exotic rocky planet, one which enters in and out of the habitable zone, with oceans completely freezing for months and liquefying in others. The spacecraft slows down, enters the planet's atmosphere. It analyzes it, very little oxygen. It decides that it would need to artificially create oxygen for its human inhabitants. They will not be able to leave a life-supported system. It explores the planet further, finds a suitable spot, and lands. It sends a signal to Earth and the 9 other spacecrafts. It has touched ground. The spacecraft sends out drones to explore the land around it for resources. It found very large quantities of gold alongside significant quantities of copper, iron, and methane within a 500-kilometer radius of its landing location. It analyzes how it will collect and use those resources. It formulates a plan and begins preparation to create a life support system for its human inhabitants. The year is now 3002. The spacecraft has built a New York City-sized facility made mostly of gold. It has also built an artificial uterus system, which has given birth to the first ever human on an alien planet. The spacecraft sends a signal to Earth and the 9 other spacecrafts. Humanity has now reached another solar system. The year is 3032. There are 1,400 adult humans on the planet and 330 children born from those non-Earth parents. The spacecraft has built 10 more spacecrafts and included embryos from its human inhabitants. It launches those spacecrafts to more systems.
The year is 3254. Ship Alpha 423 has arrived at the Barnard Star System, a system with a single red dwarf star. The spacecraft scours it for a suitable location. Many rocky planets found, one directly in the habitable zone, with conditions similar to Earth. Lots of liquid water, seasonal shift, and active tectonic activity. Only one problem. The atmosphere does not have enough oxygen. The spacecraft analyzes the situation. It can fix the atmosphere, but it will take some time. Its human inhabitants will have to live in a life-supported system, for now. The year is 3301. The spacecraft has built a life-supported complex larger than Mexico City. 1,702 adult humans and 215 children live in the complex. Alpha 423 has built 10 more spacecrafts with human embryos from its human inhabitants. It's launching those spacecrafts during that year. Almost 25,000 years since Mission Mankind was launched, humanity has expanded to more than 260,000 solar systems. The population across all these systems has now reached more than 800 trillion. Almost 500,000 years since Mission Mankind was launched, humanity has expanded to more than 600 million solar systems. The population, almost 2,000 quadrillion. Over time, humanity evolved. There are now almost 20 million different species of humans. Almost 25 million years later, ship Alpha Beta 423S, part of many spacecrafts developed 50,000 years after the launch of Mission Mankind, one built solely for traveling between galaxies and capable of traveling at an average speed of 10% the speed of light over very large distances, has now reached the Andromeda Galaxy, Milky Way's closest major galaxy, and expanded to one of the star systems within it. The year is 83,007,087. Humanity has expanded to almost every single solar system in the Milky Way galaxy. Over 340 billion solar systems. The population, 1,000 quintillion in the galaxy alone. There are now 2,200 billion official different species within the Milky Way. In that time, through intergalactic spacecrafts, humanity has also expanded to many other galaxies. The year is now 1 billion. How far did humanity reach without going anywhere near the speed of light? 2,400 large galaxies, 47,000 dwarf galaxies, 300 trillion solar systems, the population, 1 million quintillion, and a number of different species of humans so diversified that the collective population is no longer referred to as humanity.
So you can see from all of this that we don't need to travel faster than the speed of light in order to go far in space. However, everything has its drawbacks, including the method I described to you. The biggest drawback is the fact that it relies way too much on artificial intelligence. And you know what happens with artificial intelligence if you give it too much freedom. There's a chance that it would actually wipe you out. There's a real threat of that happening. At the same time, we're also assuming through our journey that we wouldn't encounter alien life, all kinds of alien life, and that brings all sorts of ethical issues with it, because in our case, our roles would be reversed from what we usually see in the movies. We would be the invaders, not the invadees. Also, there are ethical issues with sending human embryos on their own to be taken care of by an artificial entity. With all that said, however, if it turns out that faster than light travel is really impossible, then the method I described to you would still be an excellent choice to go farther than what we could imagine. Thank you very much. I will see you next time.